I'm here to speak about non-duality and intimate relationship. So we just listened to it, you know, spoken about in terms of trauma. We've heard it spoken of in terms of many things during this conference, but now we're going to explore how non-dual wisdom and understanding influences our intimate human relationship. And I'm also going to discuss the paradox of that. That there's a conventional understanding is that there's an intimacy, a relationship between two, and the non-dual truth that we're exploring here at the conference is that there isn't actually two, that in essence we have the same being, we're just one shared being at our core, exactly the same, no difference, and at the same time that being is expressing itself in an infinite number of bodies and personalities and conditionings, each completely unique, no one of us ever the same. And that's something that I'm appreciating here at this conference, that each person has their own unique expression of this one truth. You know, we're all talking about the same thing, but everybody has a different way of expressing it. So this will be my way. and speaking of the paradox, that really there's a duet of one, and it's not a duet of Zen. I'm sorry, there was a mistake in the program that called it a duet of Zen. This really has nothing to do with Zen, but it has a lot to do with non-duality. And I like the term other self, because that includes both the relative and the absolute truth that I just described, you know, that we have the same one being, but it's expressing itself in this infinite variety. So obviously there's other bodies here, and each other body has a very different perspective on things, but it's just one self, capital S. And in truth, we are always and only in relationship to our other self. So I'm going to explore how we can both wake up more to that truth and bring it more directly into our relating. And I'd like to do that in a really simple and practical way that is hopefully accessible. And I prefer to use the term relating, because relationship is, you know, thought of as something, as I said, between two. It's more of a thing than relating, which is a living dynamic with all things and applies more to what I'm saying. And when we bring this non-dual truth down into our relating, I call that awakened relating. And awakened relating is a very new exploration. It's a little different than, you know, what we know of as conscious relationship, where we become more mindfully aware of our patterns that we bring into a relationship, and we know, we have insight into them, and we're able to take responsibility for them, and so on. But we can have a conscious relationship without necessarily having awakened awareness. So what I'm going to be speaking about is more of a direct non-dual approach applied to relationship. How can we bring awakened awareness into our relating and begin with that? And to me, this is a very important exploration because, you know, as we all know, we all struggle in so many ways with our closest relationships. And there really isn't any other true solution to that than bringing this non-dual truth in, including that, so that we're not forgetting the self part of our other self, that we're just including, you know, what is actually true. And the root cause of all the struggles that we have in all of our relational interactions is the belief in separation and duality. We can say that, you know, there's other causes, like we have relational wounding, which we all do in some degree, and our conditioning and so on. But deeper than that is the belief in separation and duality, which I see as the root cause of all of our struggles. So it's so important, necessary really, to include this, because otherwise we're just dealing with the secondary causes and we can deal with that forever. It's kind of like trying to pull out weeds, you know, without pulling at the top, without pulling out the roots, and they just grow back. And I also see the belief in separation and duality as being the root cause of all of the serious issues that we see in our planet today. Because most people are relating in that division, as though there are separate others and there's us versus them, and more and more and more division being created in our world, and more serious levels of insanity that's coming out of this relating in division. So to me, it's very important to address the issue at the root, both personally and collectively. We can pull it out at the root, then possibly we can transform the serious issues we face, both personally in our lives and collectively. And it needs to start here, right? We can't change our world. It's now full of endless wars. If we're at war here, we're at war with our partner at home. So that's why I feel that this is important. It's almost like I think that there's a evolutionary imperative right now to evolve our relating to be more in alignment with what's actually true. So we're just simply talking about connecting with what's actually true, that everyone is our other self, that we're just one shared being, you know, appreciating and sharing the differences. Yet somehow this is a great challenge to us. As my teacher Ajashanti says, to remain as we are, which is simply the light of awakeness in the midst of relationship, is the most challenging thing that a human being can do. So we're going to where there's the greatest challenge, you know, to just stay as we are, awake as we are, in the midst of relating, particularly intimate relating. And why are we so challenged there? You know, first of all, it's like where we're the most vulnerable, right? You know, that's where we open the most deeply ourselves to others, and where our earliest and deepest wounding can get triggered the strongest, and where the potential is for the deepest hurt. And so we're very vulnerable there. And that's why it's such a deep challenge. And if we do have, which as I said, everybody has in varying degrees, some relational wounding because we were raised in separation and duality, right? So there's some level of that. And when that gets triggered off in relationship, that's an enormous challenge, you know, to stay present in that and rest in that. It's also where the belief in separation and the separate other tends to be the strongest, you know, where we cling the most to the idea of the special other that's going to love us and be there for us in some kind of special way. It's like one of our sacred cows, you know, something that we have a difficulty letting go of, the idea of the special other. And even people with very deep very deep non-dual awakening and understanding can still be in intimate relating and slip right into relating as though there's an other. That the conditioning there is very, very, very deep. So this is, we could say, it's kind of a final frontier of non-dual awakening and embodiment. But that's why it's so rich and fertile for deeper awakening for all of us, and for deeper transformation of our world, to be able to evolve our awakening in these ways. And there's also a very deep belief that's ingrained in our whole collective consciousness that love is found in another, that we seek love in others. And this is rarely even questioned, you know, it's just kind of understood, you know, we're just looking for love in others. I found love in another. And there can be some resistance. I know in my own life I felt I had such resistance to letting that go. I thought that something was really going to be lost if I let that go. If I truly stood in the truth that I already am the love that I'm seeking, I was going to lose something, you know, about this magic of romance and love that we're all so like so much in so many ways and have so much trouble with at the same time. And so maybe you can just contemplate that for a minute yourself and see if you feel any resistances to that. Maybe you've never really directly explored it, or maybe you have. But just feel into, you already are the love that you seek. And what if you knew that beyond any doubt? That it was absolutely clear. You were the love that you seek, no need to seek anywhere. And how might that change the way that you're relating to others, particularly the special intimate other? It's also true that, you know, if we recognize deeply that this love is already here, that we still love to be in relationship. You know, it's just the way that the human part of us loves to be in relationship, loves to be close and connected, and we would still seek relationship. But it wouldn't be coming from a place of, I'm here, you're over there, separate from me, and I'm seeking love in you. We're not operating from need. You know, it's kind of like being full, and there's the food in front of you, and you're already full. So there's no need. But at the same time, you know, there's a natural movement to share the love, to give the love. Yeah, it's a natural movement to do that. So I'm interested in just putting this in really simple, practical terms to make it accessible to as many people as possible. Like, how can this happen? So I put it together into what I call the three R's of awakened relating. And the first one is to recognize this aware presence that we are. As I said, awakened relating begins with that. So how can we access that? And I feel that at this time, maybe it's because of the evolutionary imperative I spoke of, or whatever, that this is accessible to more and more people through simple pointings, similar to, for example, what Rupert Spira uses in his teaching, which is, are you aware? And everybody can look right now and just see, am I aware? It's a simple, self-evident experience that we are all aware. And then often we're aware too much about what we're aware of, but not so much the awareness itself. Or we can just stop thinking for a moment and see that there's something here in that space, in that gap. There's an awake presence that's here. So those are very simple ways to see that there's something here. We don't know what it is, but we can see that there's something here, that it's not a nothing, that it's awake and aware and empty, and we can put all these words on it. But this, just to get one glimpse of this, is not difficult. It's very, very, very accessible. And how many of you have a sense of that, of this awareness that I'm pointing to right now? So that's most people. And if you have just even one little glimpse of that, then you qualify for what I'm calling awakened relating. Because you have a little glimpse of there's something here. And if for some reason you feel like you don't, you know, just use those little inquiries and just keep doing that, to just keep pausing the thinking and seeing, there's something here, and you're aware. And this simple awareness that's here at all times, we tend to overlook that. And oftentimes, you know, and I've pointed this out to people sometimes, and then they've like, so? You know, like, I'm aware. And maybe at first glimpse, right at the top, then we don't necessarily know that that's infinite love and everything we've ever looked for and ever could ever want on into infinity. But it is. And so we have to start somewhere with a little glimpse. So recognize is the beginning, finding a way to recognize this that's always here. And that's like, to me, that's, you know, awakening 101. And I'm trying to just take non-dual awakening down from these far-reaching clouds of something that's kind of inaccessible and abstract, you know, down into some kind of immediate practical accessibility. And then into our everyday life, and particularly the nitty-gritty of intimate relating, where there's a lot of gritty, you know, for most people. So we need to bring in this infinite wisdom. As I said, this intimate wisdom and this understanding that we're not separate, which is the source of all the problems. So we need to go to that source and turn to this. So the second R is rest. First we recognize and then we rest in this. Because it's one thing to recognize it, then another thing to turn to it again. So once we have a sense of it and a sense of the value of it, that's the other thing. We need a sense of a value of it enough to be able to turn to it and rest in that again. So whatever sense you have of that awareness right now, you can just relax back into that. It's a kind of attending to it without attending to something. It's just resting the mind into a deeper quiet, a deeper presence or awareness that's underlying all of our thoughts, then maybe we can just get a moment of that. And the rest can, it's okay if it only lasts for a moment before the mind takes you away somewhere, then we come back and we keep resting in that. And the more we keep resting in that, the more it makes itself known. And then we have a chance of getting to know the nature of it and getting to know how it is a deep and profound love there. But we won't get to know that unless we rest in it. And that takes a lot of commitment and dedication to do that. And then resting in it won't help with our relationship struggles so much unless we actually rely on it. So that's the third R, that we rely on it, that we come to trust it, that this is what we turn to, that this is the source of all of our solutions for everything that we're struggling with each other. So we recognize it, and we rest in it repeatedly, and we rely on it. And the more that we rest in it, the more we learn to trust it, the more we learn that it's something that's always here, that never fails us, that is a source of wisdom and support at all times. And the more that we rely on it, the more we rest in it, and the more that it can inform our relating. So it's about allowing that deeper love that we are to inform how we relate. And to not have too many ideas about what that actually looks like, because it's not some kind of idea of perfection, that awakened relating is where everybody's always nice to each other at all times and nobody ever gets angry. And it can look like anything or anything. It's a matter of where it's coming from. It's conceivable that we could even be yelling at somebody, but it's coming from pure love and doesn't do harm. So it doesn't look like any particular way, and it doesn't mean there's never any conflict. Because as we're in relationship to our other self, with the other part, you know, there's so many differences. We all have so many differences that then produce different points of view, and there's conflict. And conflict is part of human interaction. It's part of the beauty of it. But what's important is, where are we meeting that from? Are we meeting that from a deeper understanding and acceptance of all of it? So I can only just really touch on this so briefly here. But so maybe we could, what we could do is take a look at, you know, just kind of bring to mind, another really quick inquiry, bring to mind the last time you were in some kind of conflict in relationship or some difficulty. And what did you turn to? You know, we have this choice of turning to this deeper, infinite wisdom and love, the source of all solutions, or we can go to our mind field, our conditioned mind, reified knowledge base, and rummage through the trash and look for a solution that at best will be, you know, limited and temporary, which isn't really a choice. That's another thing we come to see, we don't really have a choice. We start turning to this more. And without judgment, just seeing how much do we rest in that, do we turn to that, and how much do we go to other things. And we're all very knowledgeable here. We all have all kinds of relationship skills and understanding, and we can go to those things, which is fine. But what do we trust first? What do we trust the most deeply to inform what we do? And even those things, when they're informed by that deeper wisdom, are effective in a way they're not otherwise. I'd like to take this couple of minutes to just say that I just feel like I barely touched on this. I didn't realize how fast this was going to go. And if you want to explore this more deeply, you can read my book, where I explore it quite extensively in all areas of relationship, communication, sexuality, conflict. And that I'm not just sharing from myself, but I had conversations with people from all over the world. Some of them are in this room who are sharing their stories of awakened relating. And some, it was truly a community effort, a non-dual community effort, including some non-dual teachers, Ajashanti and Mukti, and Rupert Spira and Ellen Emmett, and John Prendergast and Christiane, and others, as well as my clients who share stories of being with their relational wounding, which we need to bring that awakened awareness into that and be able to sit with that before we have a chance to be with it as it's triggered in relationship. That's another whole discussion. So I explore all of that, and I invite you to look at that. It's just coming out now on Kindle, and the paperback will be out soon. And it's my deepest intention. Undivided love, a guide to awakened relating. And my deepest intention with that book is to bring more awakened relating to our world, both personally and collectively. Thank you.